Stand by, Senator.
WATD presents Monday Night Talk with State Senator Bob Hedlund.
Senator Hedlund, I think at times has probably been fairly courageous in decisions he's made.
So with the people on that issue, not the politicians.
I have five words for America. This is your wake-up call.
I would love the opportunity to be on your show. Well, you know, I wanted to see just what kind of guts you guys really have.
What do you mean? How am I a jerk?
I don't know. Who loves you, baby?
We love you, baby.
I love you, baby.
Thanks for listening.
Monday Night Talk.
We'll let you get back to your Democratic love fest, and we appreciate your time tonight.
For those of you that know me, I'm an easygoing guy, and I can work... And I can work with just about anyone.
There have been an awful lot of things that, especially that your program has said about me, which I resented very, very strongly.
You obviously got a complaint with me. What do you want to do? What do you want me to do?
Go ahead, Bob. Keep it up. Keep it up.
There are some who feel like that, you know, the conditions are such that they can attack us there. My answer is bring them on.
Monday Night Talk with State Senator Bob Hedlund on 95.9 WATD.
Welcome and good evening to another edition of Monday Night Talk. I am your host, State Senator Bob Hedlund, here on WATD 95.9 FM in Marshfield, Massachusetts, where every Monday night from about 6:15 to 8 p.m., the South Shore's radio station becomes the South Shore's talk station. Well, the summer concert season is upon us in full swing, and we've got a number of great acts coming to the Boston area. We're going to be joined during this show by one of those acts. We'll hear from him live here on WATD. And we're going to give away some tickets for that performance at the South Shore Music Circus throughout the show. It is none other than the Charlie Daniels Band. If you like good rock and roll or country or country rock or southern rock, Charlie has had an illustrious career. He's actually 70 years old now, if you can believe that. Mm. But he still cranks like a guy half his age. And he's going to be appearing at the Music Circus over in Cohasset Sunday, June 24th, 7:30 p.m. And also at the Cape Cod Melody Tent previous day, June 23rd, Saturday night, 8 p.m. And there are tickets available for both shows. And we'll be giving some away this evening.
Yeah, they were.
They were going to the top of the music world, or were close to the top of the music world at that time. They were really popularizing that genre.
The eagle's been flying slow, and the flag's been flying low, and a lot of people saying that America's fixing to fall. But speaking just for me and some people from Tennessee, we got a thing or two to tell you all. This lady may have stumbled.
Well, Charlie Daniels, welcome aboard WATD here in Marshfield, Massachusetts, and thank you very much for joining us. How are you tonight?
Thank you, sir. It's an honor to be with you. I'm doing fine. I appreciate it.
It is truly an honor to have you aboard, and we're joined in studio by Ed and George. They're the music guys here on WATD. I'm the talk guy here.
Nice talking with you, Charlie. I'm glad you're on board.
Well, I live in both worlds, so we'll get along good.
Charlie, you do. You do. I saw you on, I don't know if it was CNN or Fox not too long ago. And you have been very vocal, and I find myself in sync with most of, probably 90% of what I've seen you say on your soapbox. And I really want to just take a minute to commend you for stepping out, saying what you believe. I know there's a lot of performers on the left who are vocal and say what they believe. We don't see that too much on the conservative side of the political spectrum.
That's for sure. I was looking.
Because you pay a price sometimes with the Hollywood and the media elite.
Well, sometimes I think standards and beliefs are more important than whether somebody else likes you. And I was looking at your February 17th edition of the Soapbox with all the immigration talk. And I'll tell you, I commend you. I congratulate you on having the courage to say what's really the truth out there.
Well, thank you very much. I don't know any other way to do but that. You know, the thing in America to me is I wish everybody would express their opinion because
they're afraid to.
I know, but I mean, that's, you know, it's ridiculous to be that way. You say the way you feel about things. I've had people, you know, always say, well, aren't you afraid you'll offend somebody? Well, hell yeah,
who cares?
I'm going to offend some people. There's no doubt about it.
That's right.
You know, if you're coddling up to people, just trying to please them. You're not saying anything. I mean,
no,
you're right.
And you're not defending America.
Absolutely.
Hey, no. Charlie, I had the opportunity to see you about 1985 at the South Shore Music Circus. Great show. It was the first time I saw you. Then I saw you up in New Hampshire a few years back. And then I think about 99, the Volunteer Jam came through Great Woods, now the Tweeter Center. You had with you Marshall Tucker and Molly Hatchett. And three times I've been able to see you. Great show. I'm looking forward to seeing you on the 24th. You're going to be here on the South Shore. And we've urged our listeners to get out there and see your show. You put on a great show. And I know there's a few tickets still available. And how are things on the road?
Well, we're just having a good time. We're kind of starting to really getting into the meat of our year now. You know, we start out about April usually, and we'll go out for a few days and come home. And the trips are getting a little longer now and a little further. I just came in from out west. We've already been to the West Coast one time this year, and we'll go back a couple more times before it's over with. We'll do the Alaska State Fair this year. We'll be on the East Coast, West Coast. You know, I mean, we just travel all over the place, and I love every minute of it.
And I'm sure you've seen every casino there is to see in the United States of America by now.
I've seen a bunch of them, partner. You wouldn't believe how many of them there is. I think they're about everywhere now.
Hey, I got the opportunity to get to know the guys in Molly Hatchett, the latest incarnation of Molly Hatchett over about the last 8-9 years. They've come through here a few times, and I had the good fortune to be able to hang out with them. Some real characters there. You did a collaboration with them. Great, great song called Gypsy Trail. I have the CD, and I listen to that often. I've got to ask you the question, Charlie, of all the collaborations you've done, and you've worked with some great people. I think you did some work with Leonard Skinner. What's your favorite collaboration of all time?
Well, I couldn't actually call it a collaboration, but working with people on maybe their projects. There's been so many. I've worked with a couple of the Beatles, worked with Bob Dylan. I've wrote a song that Elvis Presley recorded. I've done a bunch of stuff, and it's all good, and it's all, you know, pleasant memories and everything, but I'm just myself, I'm just so in love with the music. I'm 70 years old. I've been doing this. I'm now in my 50th year as a professional musician, but the summer of 08 will complete my 50th year. I started in 1958 as a full-time professional musician. So, you know, I love it all. I love doing it all. You asked me a question, I should be answering it. But I've had some wonderful times. It would be hard to pick, you know, one thing out of the many, many things that I have done. But it's been fun working with, and we still work with a lot with the Marshall Tucker Band. And we've done more dates with Marshall Tucker than any band we have ever worked with. Doing a tour now with Marshall Tucker.
You got the Outlaws out with you also, right?
Yeah, and it's a great show. We're doing something that we haven't done, hadn't been done in a long time. We bring all three bands back on stage at the end of the night and do this humongous jam, you know?
Yeah, those are great. Is Huey Thomason back in the Outlaws?
Huey is back, and he's just picking his brains out, man. I mean, this guy mm-hmm. can play a guitar, and he's such a great guy. He's so much fun to work with. It's like working with a bunch of old friends, you know. So that's part of our tour. That's part of what we're doing. And then, of course, we're doing the CDB dates. You know, it's always never a problem what to play, but when you've got as many albums out as we have, it's always a problem about what do you leave off? Not what you put on, but what do you leave off? So we go through the first of the year and we put together. You know, we always do the songs that people expect us to do. Devil Went Down to Georgia. That's going to do it, you know, Woolly Swamp.
Charlie, I got to ask you a question about the South's Going to Do It Again.
Sure.
That was probably the first song that brought me to you, you know, led me to the Charlie Daniels Band when I was a little younger. And I have to ask the question, I was thinking about this on the ride down to the station tonight. If you were to pen the South's Going to Do It Again today, what bands would you, or performers would you work into that song in this day and age?
It would be a bunch of them. I'll tell you what, we'd have to consider, Hootie and the Blowfish and Travis Tritt.
I knew Travis Tritt was going to be in there. I knew it.
Yeah, well, he's one of my favorites. Travis is the whole package. You think, you see people who have all us old guys, we cut our teeth in the beer joints where we played, you know, six nights a week, four or five shows a night. And, you know, you learn your craft by doing it just over and over and over again. And Travis is one of those guys that kind of came out of that world, that the point being when he got his record contract, he was ready to back it up. There was nothing green about him. Travis was ready to entertain. He's a fine guitar player, a fine singer, a fine songwriter, an entertainer, and he has the whole package. I mean, that's what you're looking for. That's why people stay around for a long time, is when they're a combination of all those things. So, yeah, Travis is one of my very special favorites. I just did a piece on him. In fact, Travis has been doing it, working with an album, doing an album with, what's the guy's name on I Don't Watch American, whatever that big talent show.
Yeah, we're not going to name that name of that show.
I can't remember. I'm going to name it. But anyway, one of the guys that works on it is a record producer, one of the judges. Randy Jackson, is that his name?
Yes, yes.
He's doing an album with Travis right now.
Really?
Yeah, I did a fiddle part on it the other day. Travis
good.
In Nashville, and we did. But we worked together. We've written together. And I'm doing a duet album, and Travis did a song with me on my album. So we worked together quite a bit, and I have the utmost admiration for the young man. He's quite a talent.
Charlie, my first vote came in 1980. I voted in my first presidential election that year. I was fresh out of high school. Mm-hmm. And we were suffering from that kind of malaise that we saw in the late 70s and what happened with the Iranian hostage crisis. You came out with a song that got airplay, I think, on country stations. Certainly it went up the charts on the rock stations. Blew me away when I first heard it. Every time I hear it, I get goosebumps. It'll be the highlight for me of your show on June 24th at the Music Circus. But the song In America.
Uh-huh.
And I guess, can you tell us about that song? I got a two-part question. Tell us about the song. But the other thing is, you know, with what's happening now, it's almost like we're reliving this and talk of this conflict with Iran and Joe Lieberman suggesting preemptive strikes. I mean, who would have thought 20... some odd years later, we reliving
this talking
to
about
a degree.
This, right, yeah.
Well, I would like to say one word about Mr. Lieberman to start with. I have the utmost respect for that man because he sticks with what he believes in. I don't know the man. I've never met him, but I got to say one thing. He's got a lot of guts.
Yep, yep.
Yeah.
Principles.
Yeah, principles, absolutely, and I have an awful lot of respect for him. Let me go back and address the first part of your question. In America is a direct result of the Iranian hostage crisis. I had seen the demise, not the demise, but it's just kind of downplaying of patriotism at the last part of the Vietnam War. It was a media thing, basically, was what it was. I think it's been proven right now we could have won that war, had it won, in fact, had it not been for a lot of things that happened. I won't go into that. But anyway, it had not been fashionable to be patriotic. Of course, I've always been patriotic, and when this hostage crisis happened, I kept hearing these remarks like, well, how dare they? We ought to go over there and do this and that. And I said, this is the reawakening of patriotism, that people are showing that they do care about America and they do think that America ought to stand up for itself. And that's where the line, you never did think that it ever would happen again in America, you know, and that's exactly where it came from, was as a direct result of the Iranian hostage crisis.
And here we are again.
Yes. Well, we are... You know, and the thing about it is, we have never had an enemy that actually followed us home. We've been very blessed in that way, that God has blessed this country above any other country that I have ever been in, and we have always, you know, we've always won our wars, they say we lost Vietnam. I still don't quite go along with that. I think we gave it away, but the situation now is, we have an enemy that is not only, you know, concerned with defeating us overseas, but they want to come here and do it. And we've never had that happen. And people have always come in mass. And these people come one or two at a time and cause all this mass destruction. We are in a very, very dangerous situation in the world. And, you know, my problem is, I think there's a lot of people, and some of them in Washington, D.C., that don't understand what we're up against here, what we are facing, in that we are faced with a very dangerous, tenacious enemy who is absolutely dedicated to the downfall of everything that America stands for. And until we get that under our belt and we understand it, they're going to come at us from every direction. I've been in Iraq 2 times, and I have yet to see the war that they show on CNN. The guys and gals over there are doing a great job. They are winning. I mean, I know that's not what people believe, but I'm telling you, when I left, I asked a guy, I said, what can I tell America for you? He said, just tell them we're winning. And it's like, you know, you can't, they can do no right, because as far as the media is concerned, and that's the picture that people are getting of the war is what they see on television.
Well, don't you find, Charlie, that the whole situation, we're dealing with an overseas enemy, but the fact that you have media that are so left-wing, the fact that you have so many factions in this country that are chipping away, we have a very serious internal enemy right now.
Oh, definitely. You know what scares me is that once Pandora's box is open, you can't get the lid back on.
That's it.
And we are, it doesn't take, when I talk about naive people in Washington, I mean, that don't understand, it's like once you give away a piece of this country, it's going to be hell getting it back.
Oh, yeah.
And I don't think they understand that, and I think these people are playing political games. Who was it? John Edwards said that the war on terror was a bumper sticker.
Yeah, I mean, how pathetic is that?
It's not only pathetic, it's dumb, it's naive.
That's
and it's
scary.
Downright dangerous.
Hey, he's one of your Southern boys. What
no,
can I tell you?
No, he's not one of my Southern boys. He's a Southern boy, but he ain't one of mine. This guy is completely and totally out of touch, and that is an example of somebody appealing to, you know, what they perceive to be the left wing of their party to do anything to get votes.
Yep.
And that's what's wrong with politics.
Hey, there's a guy that supported trade agreements that put his own people in his own state out of work, and now he's worried about the poor. But Charlie,
he's got pretty hair.
You mentioned that you've been to Iraq twice. My understanding is you've been to Afghanistan, Kyrgyzstan, Kuwait, Bosnia, Kosovo. You've visited the troops in Korea. And as a result, you just were awarded the Silver Helmet Award by the AMVETS Association, and you've been going out and playing for the troops now for four decades. Is that correct?
Well, yeah. You know, that is a labor of love.
Thank you for that.
Oh well, thank you. Thank God I can do it. These are the finest people, the best representation of America we have are our troops. So many things that are wrong with American youth nowadays. The disrespect, the not being a responsible person, responsible, the drugs, the this, that, doesn't exist in the military. These guys are, I mean, they're straight ahead. They're healthy, they're clear-eyed, they're drug-free, they have a sense of purpose, and they do it because they want to and not because they have to. Every time I've run into, I saw a bunch of guys getting off the, when you see a soldier, if that flag is turned backwards, the flag they wear on their shoulder, if it's turned, that means they have been into battle.
Right.
You can always tell that, and I saw a bunch of kids coming in on our plane in Dallas where I was changing planes the other day, and I mean, it just makes you proud. They all had those flags turned.
It's an attention getter, that's for sure.
They're just the best. They're just the finest we've got to offer, and I have so much respect for them. And when I hear some half-brained politician going off on them, it just literally makes me want to put my hands around.
Present company excluded, Charlie, right? Yeah.
Yes, ma'am. Yes,
well,
sir.
I think,
yes,
Charlie, this is George. I think that the sheep follow the media whether they're right or wrong, and that's the worst way you can do it, and that's what I believe anyway.
Well, you're true, and you got to stop and consider. You know, a lot of people don't really have a lot of time to get.
No, they don't. I mean, they have the family.
They come home in the afternoon and they watch, watch on the network,
and they believe the networks.
Yeah, and they do. But I am here to tell you there is a definite prejudice there. Did you know the BBC actually admitted that they leaned left?
Is that right?
Yes, they did. I heard it on the radio today, and they have actually admitted that their people that work in their newsrooms are very liberal people, and they have a left leaning. And if you ever watch the BBC, I was in Germany during the Abu Ghraib thing, and the only English speaking TV I could get was the BBC and CNN International. And all they did was beat up on America. They talked about Abu Ghraib, and how horrible it was. And all it was, they acted as if the whole United States military were that way, and all it was a handful of people, and they still didn't cut anybody's head
off. They always beat a dead horse.
Charlie, Senator Hedlund here. I'm good, very good friends with the rock band The Scorpions. I'm sure you're familiar with them.
Well, we never worked together.
No, I wouldn't expect that you would have, but... you may have crossed paths somewhere or someplace, but it's funny, whenever I get together with them, they want to talk politics, I want to talk music, and I see that occurring here. I suppose if I was a musician, I'm going to want to talk politics.
Let's talk music.
Before we get to music, I got to throw a question out for you. I looked, and by the way, this is kind of funny, I saw you up in Manchester, New Hampshire a few years ago with my best friend, his wife, and it was just prior to my birthday, and I guess she didn't know what to get me for my birthday. She bought me membership in the Leonard Skinner fan club and the Charlie Daniels fan club. So I got your newsletter regularly, and I went back and I looked at your website today, and if anyone wants to counter what they hear on BBC, they can go to Charlie Daniels' website and check out his soapbox to get some of that counter. But I think your best post that you've put up may have been your most recent. It's dated 6/15/07, where you talk about a nation of laws or not in the immigration situation. And if I could, Charlie, can I read just two quick lines and let you respond?
Yes, sir.
One is, you talk about amnesty potentially being granted to unknown millions of illegals, and it says that it's an undeniable signal right there who wants this legislation. Big business can dilute the labor market, bring wages down, and finish the job started by NAFTA and moving their manufacturing plants out of the country that buys the bulk of their product. How many rock and rollers or country stars out there nowadays could explain to you about NAFTA? You know, and this is, by the way, one area where conservatives can join with the left, and be in unison on this issue over what NAFTA has done to this country. And I'm going to read one more line and let respond. Because we are, by the way, we are broadcasting within the wattage here of WATD. We do hit the Kennedy compound. You have a line here that says, do you think that Ted Kennedy suffers when the economy goes south? Do you think he worries about crime in the street? Ever hear of the Kennedy compound in Hyannis, Mass? Well, Charlie, now's your chance. He's probably listening. We're in his area down in Hyannis.
Well, I wrote open a letter and invited Mr. Kennedy to go to Iraq with me the last time I went.
Hey, forget that, Charlie. You are going to be performing in his backyard.
I've done it before. I hope
on June 23rd, you're at the Cape Cod Melody Tent in Hyannis. Maybe you can.
Opens his window, so maybe. Hey, come see us, Mr. Ted.
Send him a couple comps.
We'll introduce you. You know something? I got to go back and tell you something. My bus driver told me the other day. We're talking about NAFTA. The trucks that come out of Canada, we always get the wrong end of the stick when we do something like that. We always end up with the lion's share of the cost while everybody else reaps the benefits.
Yeah.
But so many, my driver was telling me the other night when he stops at truck stops that these trucks, so many of these trucks are driven by, you know, Middle Eastern type people, which is fine. I don't have anything against anybody making a living. It's not that. But then you stop and think about the logistics of what could happen with one bad apple that we don't have control over coming into this country from another country, that we can't possibly control all those trucks that come in. The point being that, you know, I think that NAFTA decreases our vigilance. I think that it takes jobs away from America. I don't think it's even begun to take as many as it's going to. And my point being that, you know, this, if we don't stand up for ourselves, and when it comes to what's going on now, and what's, if we don't defeat this thing that's going on that Mr. Kennedy and Mr. Bush and the Congress are trying to, the Senator are trying to put over on us, this is going to be something that we can never, I don't think we will ever overcome it.
It's going to be catastrophic.
Charlie, thank you for throwing George Bush's name in on this issue.
Absolutely.
When you mentioned NAFTA, you know why? There was recently an op-ed by a former Republican governor of Massachusetts, and George Bush has delivered the same message. He wants to. They talk about the free movement of goods. Now they want the free movement of labor. They want to erase the borders between
Abu Zubaydah, Ramzi Al-Sheib, or whatever the guy's name was.
They want to erase the borders between Mexico, United States, Canada, and the United States.
Well, on the one hand, they tell us that Social Security is going broke, and on the other hand, they want to put 20 million more people on it.
Right. Yeah, that makes a lot of sense.
Let me ask you something. How long, people say, well, they take jobs that, let me tell you something. I have nothing against any ethnic group. I have nothing against Mexicans. But you can't make the first act that you do when you come into this country breaking the law. We've got a 200-some-year tradition of people doing it the right way.
Yeah.
And we don't know who you are, we don't know where you are, we don't know what diseases you've got, we don't know who comes in here. This thing does just not include just people south of the border. We're talking about people from all over the world.
Well, I heard an interesting story the other day about a doctor in Iceland that's been trying to get acceptance into the country for 6 years, and they keep turning him down. He's finally given up because he says, why should I keep trying when they're letting millions of illegals in?
Well,
that's sad.
It is sad. It's very sad, and it's, you know, we need to tighten the situation. Once this takes place, you know, it's going to be it's going to be horrible. It's going to really mess this country up, and you know, it's like I say, big business. Of course, they're trying for it. It's just like the big business now supporting, you know, socialized medicine. The reason being, it takes the burden off of them.
Yeah.
But we can't listen to them. We can't. Socialized medicine and this immigration bill will be our undoing.
I kind of think, Charlie, if this does happen, the headline in the newspaper is going to be, "What happened?"
That's it. And it's going to be too late.
It is going to be too late.
You're never, ever going to get the genie back in the bottle.
That's right. You're not.
And it's going to happen within the next generation. I mean, that's how fast of a demographic change and how rapidly the middle class's standard of living is declining and middle class is vanishing.
Well, the thing that worries me about this immigration bill, too, if they allow extended family in and we end up with 50 million in here, we might as well start shoveling right now. It's a bad scene.
Well, the thing is, stop and consider this. What about, it's talking about people taking, you know, intensive labor jobs that Americans won't take. First place, they don't, you know, they're looking for cheap labor, but what's going to happen when they come in and find out they can live off of the government subsidies that they're going to be able to?
Well, they're already learning that, Charlie. Yes. Charlie, have you ever considered running for public office down
Absolutely
there in Tennessee?
Not. No.
Never. Did people try and recruit you?
Frivolously, I've had people say, why don't you run? But I have no desire whatsoever to be a politician. I wouldn't get along 5 minutes. I mean, they'd throw me out, you know.
I think you can do probably more good by having, doing what you're doing now, talking about it, having the soapbox, getting it out there. How often does the soapbox update it?
We do one every Monday night. In fact, there'll be one going up in just a few minutes if it's not already up, and then again every Friday night.
And how do people get it?
www.charliedaniels.com and go to the soapbox. It's you know, it's there. There's two a week up, and you know, if you want to comment, as long as you keep your comments clean. Now, mm-hmm. I'm not going to expose my readers to bad language.
I don't blame you.
And we had some anti-Semitic things that came up a while back, and I will not put up with that.
I saw that. Did someone say that you were Jewish or something?
Yeah, well, I said, you know, I don't have any Jewish blood, but if I did, I'd be proud of it. It's good enough for my Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. It's certainly good enough for me.
Yeah, there you go.
That's right. So, you know, but I mean, I won't put up with that kind of thing. And not just anti-Semitic, but anti-black or anti-anything, I won't put up with. Other than that, if you want to make a comment, if you read what I've said and you agree with it or you disagree with it, there's a space for you to write in and say, hey, I think you're full of it, or, you know, I like what you said, or I'm kind of straddle the fence on it. But yeah, we encourage comment. We encourage dialogue.
Charlie, can I get back to music just for a second?
Yes,
can I sneak a music question
please,
in?
Please.
Getting kind of pushy, aren't you?
the theme of the show, we got off politics tonight, and we've been talking about music and what the real golden era or decade was for music. I'm advocating that the 80s, I recognize great
things. I'm advocating the 50s.
But I'm advocating that the 80s got kind of a bum rap. We got a 50s guy here. We got a guy that's all over the map. But I want to ask that question to you. Also, I want to throw this question out. If you had written In America Now, would you have substituted the Tennessee Titans fan for Pittsburgh Steelers fan?
Absolutely. But when I come up your way, it'll be the New England Patriots.
There you go.
You're not sitting in the fence, are you, Charlie?
Nah. I do the local at night when we go into different places.
Yeah.
People seem to get a kick out of it, you know.
Oh, sure.
But, yeah, I love my Titans. I tell you what, I don't know if you heard about our errant player, Mr. Pac-Man Jones, got in trouble again today.
Oh,
in
Atlanta.
So
what's new?
This might be it for him. I don't
know. These people have tons and tons of money, and they have everything handed to them, and they act so stupid. I mean, where are they coming from?
You got me. I don't know. I guess the guy's just a punk. He's just going to be a punk, you know. But it's a shame because he's a good ball player. But, you know, you have something to consider. What kind of role model is this guy being for kids that want to be?
A zero.
These people
don't think they'll have. I mean, you ought to clean. You need to clean up your act if you're going to make $1 million
a
year. You know.
Yeah. Well,
I mean, he's been let go and let. This is the 11th time he has been a person of interest to the police department somewhere or another.
Yeah. See,
he's still got this Las Vegas thing hanging over his head. Yeah. So I don't. You know.
If that was the old saying, you know, you can't make a silk purse out of a sow's ear, and I think that's the situation.
True. All right. Well, I got some other South Park.
Well, we got politics. we got politics. We got sports. So back to the gist of the show, Charlie. You've been performing since 1958. So you've spanned five. You know, you've performed now in five different decades.
Right.
What's the nostalgic
decade for you?
The one you enjoyed being around other musicians the most.
Late 60s, early 60s, for lack of a better word, I'll call the Layla era. I think that song that Larry Clapton as Layla personifies the era of music that I loved as well as any song. I can think of Allman Brothers, you know, of course, Skynyrd and Tucker, and, you know, the days when there was AOR radio where the guys used to go in and pull their own albums and play. You know, play their own things and take pride in putting a segue together of good tunes. You know, I mean, that was kind of my era.
See, those days are gone because of corporate radio and playlists. Oh, yeah. Nobody can do anything.
Tell me about it. I very well know that.
See, that's the beauty of this particular station we're on. The management here gives the DJs, and especially George and myself on Saturday nights, carte blanche.
Well, that's great.
How sweet is that?
And I know, Charlie, they're going to play a lot of Charlie Daniels this weekend, don't you guys?
Go for it. I love it.
Yep. Well, Charlie, we don't want to tie you up afternoon. Where are you calling from tonight?
I'm at home. I'm home. I just came home yesterday. I've been out west. I flew in from out in New Mexico yesterday, and I'm leaving, headed up to, not to Cohasset. We're going to Beverly and some other places up that way. I'll be there Thursday, and we're working, you know, up in the upper coast there.
Yeah, you're going to be up in Guilford, New Hampshire. That's with Tucker and Outlaws.
Yeah.
And then we're going to get you down here again. We'll give the dates for our listeners. Saturday, June 23rd, the Cape Cod Melody Tent. And then right in our backyard here on the 24th, it'll be the South Shore Music Circus. Charlie, I'm going to be there. I'm going to look forward to seeing you perform, hopefully get a chance to say hello to you.
We'll make sure that happens.
And we thank you for everything that you've done on the music front and everything that you've done for our troops.
Thanks for the soapbox.
Oh, you're so welcome. Thanks for reading it.
Sure.
Charlie Daniels, thanks for joining us, and we'll look forward to seeing you on the 24th. Be safe. God bless.
Thank you.
See you later.
WATD Marshfield.
It had not been fashionable to be patriotic. Of course, I've always been patriotic. And when this hostage crisis happened, I kept hearing these remarks like, well, how dare they? We ought to go over there and do this and that. And I said, this is the reawakening of patriotism, that people are showing that they do care about America and they do think that America ought to stand up for itself. And that's where the line, you never did think that it ever would happen again in America, you know, and that's...
Well, the eagle's been flying slow, and the flag's been flying low, and a lot of people saying that America...
This is Monday Night Talk with State Senator Bob Hedlund, 95.9 WATD.